Thompson. She received her degree in exotic animal management at Moore Park College. She has worked with exotic and domestic animals since 2005. Employed with multiple ACA accredited zoos, she has a wide range of experience from working with butterflies to giraffes. She's very passionate about zookeeping and wildlife education. She'll speak to us for about 20 minutes and then open it up for your questions for about 10 minutes. Please welcome Janice Thompson.
Purpose. So recreation used to be like repurposing zoos to become education, research, and rehabilitation. So recreation is still important. In this world, we're really disconnected from wildlife. We live in a city, we're watching television all the time, we're playing video games. We don't see where our food comes from, we're not out in nature a lot. So we're disconnected from that. So zoos give us an opportunity to get up close with nature and learn to respect and connect with the animals in our world around us. And I feel like this is extremely important, especially for our upcoming generation, to teach our kids respect for animals and wildlife and understand why it's important that these animals and nature affect our lives directly. Education is also extremely important. Like I said, teaching our children to respect nature and wildlife, but also how is wildlife affecting us directly? A lot of times we don't think that it is affecting us, that everything that's happening out there affects us directly, our food supplies, our clothing that we wear, the air that we breathe. Rehabilitation. A lot of animals get injured in the wild and there's nowhere for them to go unless places like zoos help them. A lot of animals become injured, they need to get medical care, grow up a little bit, get some nutrition, and then we can put them back into the wild. But sometimes that's not possible. And so zoos give those animals a place to live. Right now, in my career, I'm taking care of opossums and raptors, like birds of prey, raccoons. We also have at the zoo, there's bears and sea lions, and all those guys wouldn't have a home if it wasn't for the zoo. They would have just perished. So research is also important. A lot of times we think research is not all they get scared that we're doing awful things to animals, but really we're doing a lot of in-house non-invasive research that can directly affect conservation. So some easy examples I want to tell you about are marine mammals I was talking about. All those marine mammals that get stranded and beached on whales, or beached whales, there we go, I said the wrong word. We wouldn't know how to take care of those marine mammals if it wasn't for zoos. So everything that we learn about in zoos on how to take care of, you know, seals and sea lions and whales and walruses, we apply that to those animals that need to be rehabilitated, and about 80% of them go back into the wild. If we didn't have that knowledge, we wouldn't be able to help them. Another fun one is polar bears. We're doing lots of polar bears right now, and something that zoos have volunteered to help are putting radio collars on their bears in zoos to make sure that the radio collars work, to make sure that it doesn't impede with the polar bear eating or getting around. And so when we can do that and see that the collar isn't hurting them in any way, shape, or form, we can put them on red bears, and then we can track data about where those bears are going, how many bears are out there. And without that, we wouldn't know. So zoos can volunteer to participate in information. But conservation is a big thing that I wanted to talk about. Conservation has moved more and more to the forefront of zoos and the purpose of why we're there. Even just in my generation, I've seen the amount of conservation that zoos are doing increase. So in 1981, the ADA, that organization I told you about, they started a program called the Species Survival Plan, and they pick a lot of different animals that are endangered or threatened, and they started a breeding program for those species. They create genetic diversity, increase their numbers, and then potentially put them back out into the wild. Now, to put them back into the wild, yes, we do have to have habitat for them to go back to. We also have to make sure that we can track how they're doing and make sure that whatever was the cause of their numbers going down, that we can help prevent that or increase their numbers where there's not a point to putting them back out. But currently, there's over 450 species that are in this plan, and some of them that have been released back to the wild. Some examples are California condor, golden lion tamarin, which is a type of monkey, Arabian oryx, which is the antelope, and the Peregrine falcon. Now, what I get the most excited about this is when I think about how some of these species would literally be extinct without these plants. We would not have California condors alive today without zoos and the work that they did. Also, AZA, along with other zoos, to donate money directly to conservation organizations. AZA has donated over $160 million to conservation programs. So we can support conservation directly, we can send them money, but the thing that I've seen change in the last 10 years that is fun is we can also support them other ways. So just to give you an example, we can volunteer our time or our knowledge to organizations. So for example, there is an organization called Wildlife SOS in India, where they help rescue elephants that have been mistreated and they go live in sanctuaries. But the people that are taking care of them in the sanctuaries don't know much about training elephants. And so we've actually sent our staff all the way to India to train them how to take care of elephants and make sure that they're healthy. So we can actually go to new places and help them. Another thing that we can do is we can help animals that are in our own backyard. So boreal toads live right here in Utah, and the numbers are going down tremendously. And so Whole Zoo will actually have zookeepers go out into, you know, right in our own backyard, in Cottonwood Canyon, and they go count how many boreal toads they can find. And then they also take boreal toad eggs and they bring them back to the zoo and let them hatch there and develop all the way to being a toad. And then we can put them back into the wild and they have a better chance of living than if we left the eggs out in the wild and hopes that they would survive from tadpole to toad. So last time we talked about conservation, I don't know about you guys, but do you guys ever get discouraged? Like raise your hand if you like see documentaries, you're like, oh, there's nothing we can do. No one feels like that? Okay. Yeah, so you watch these shows, you're like, oh my gosh, the world's ending and I can't do anything about the polar bear, and I can't do anything about all the rainforests that are going away. Well, I want to tell you guys it can help. Sometimes we think the only way we can help is by donating money. Yes, you can donate money to conservation organizations. But you don't always have to, and that's not the only way to help. You can support zoos, of course. Come to the zoo, have fun. A percentage of your ticket goes directly towards conservation. But also, you can do things in your everyday life. The choices that you guys make affect the wildlife in your lives. So pay attention to legislation that's happening, because that's where big changes are made. Find out what laws are being made that protect animals or lands around us. Teach your children to respect wildlife. Something as simple as teaching your children not to litter affects the world. Reducing your carbon footprint. This one can be so overwhelming and discouraging, but the simplest things of keeping your car maintained, recycling, lower your thermostat, 2 degrees will save thousands of pounds of carbon emissions every year. Use reusable bags at a grocery store. You can volunteer your time. You can help organizations, whether it's at a zoo or, you know, the Humane Society. You can help. Recycle your cell phones. You guys know that there's metal in your cell phones that was mined in the Congo where the mountain gorillas live. Yeah, so a lot of people don't know that. So recycling your cell phones saves mountain gorillas. When you go out to eat and you want to have some seafood, look up Seafood Watch. Our biggest scare right now are our oceans. What's happening in our oceans affects the land. So if you go out and you're like, I'm going to go Red Lobster and just eat a big lobster dinner, maybe you shouldn't do that this year. Right now, maybe lobsters aren't sustainable. So you need to, you can still eat seafood, just do it responsibly and eat sustainable food. Seafood Watch is an organization that tells you what you can eat currently that protects the ocean. Use sustainable palm oil. This is a hard one. This is another one I think people don't realize. All processed foods have oil in them, and a real popular oil is palm oil. And to get palm oil, they are tearing down rainforests in Borneo and making palm farms. And that's killing orangutans. So it sounds awful because you're like, oh gosh, I ate an Oreo cookie, I killed an orangutan. Okay, it doesn't have to be that bad. What you do is you just have to eat foods that have sustainable oil. You don't have to eliminate palm oil, just use sustainable oil. So to find out how to do that, okay. I'm going to take this up out there. These are the things that you guys can do to help. You can go to this this website, find out how to reduce your carbon emissions. On this website, this tells you what seafood you can currently eat and protect the ocean. This is how you know if you're eating foods that have sustainable palm oil or if you're hurting orangutans. And then I encourage you to donate your cell phones. You don't know where to do it? Bring your cell phones to the zoo. Also, here's another website that takes all electronics, not just cell phones. this out here for you guys. I really want to encourage each of you guys today to commit to changing at least one thing in your life, to making a difference in your everyday choices to help wildlife, because you don't have to watch some documentaries to get depressed and think the world is ending. You can make simple choices that add up. You don't realize how much those little choices change the world, but they do. And these organizations are proof of it, that started with people that were passionate and just wanted to make a difference. So I just want you guys to say that there's still hope, and that you guys can make good choices to help animals. And what I do personally, I do try and follow these things. It can be overwhelming, but the little things, I try to follow them. But my passion took me being a zookeeper. And we know that zoos aren't perfect, but I love what I do, and I feel passionate about it. And I know that we're making good choices for our environment and for the public. So I just want to encourage you guys to support organizations that help animals. And thank you for your time, and now it's question time.
Janice, I'd just like to point out that we will take a picture of the chart, and we'll post that on the Oasis website.
Sounds good. So that's going to be on the Oasis website for you guys to help make your choices. Do you guys have any other questions?
Bad luck.
You're up.
All right. Okay. So I'm sure you've had this question before. There was a zoo tragedy recently where an elderly gorilla was put down, and I saw comments by zoo experts who said they saw the footage and he had to be put down. Now, me as an ignorant spectator also saw it, and it looked to me like maybe the gorilla was just trying to protect that child.
So I can comment on that only as an individual. So this is my own personal opinion. This doesn't represent the thoughts of where I work or places that I've worked in the past. And I'm going to make it simple, the answer simple. We do have experts that take care of those animals, and because they are real animals that can be dangerous, there are teams at zoos that help make those decisions on how to keep the public safe and how to keep the animals safe. And when you're put in one of those positions, you do have to make a choice. I personally respect the choice that was made. I think it's tragic, but it could have been more tragic to lose that child. There are safety precautions at every zoo facility to protect the wildlife or protect the animals, also protect the people. CNN put something on the news media that was really simple, and it was like five rules on how to stay safe at zoos. And not for that specific scenario, but when you go to the zoo, you do have to respect barriers, respect the animals, don't take the animals, pay attention to your children. Those things keep the public safe, and then our job as zookeepers and staff is to keep you guys safe and animals safe. That was a horrible situation. I think they had to do what they had to do, and I expect them for their decision. So that's about all I have to say about that. It's hard.
What's your view on SeaWorld finally getting around to letting the orcas go? After decades of refusal and what in my opinion is horrific abuse?
I have mixed feelings about SeaWorld. Again, these are my personal opinions. I'm actually really saddened that they're letting go of the orcas, because the research and the care that SeaWorld has put into their marine mammals and how all the research that SeaWorld has done to help with marine animal conservation and protecting our oceans is incredible. And I think they're at the forefront of technology and animal care. I wish that as individuals we put more time and patience that we might not be aware of. In Asia, there's moon bears that are put into tiny little cages, and there's tubes put into their gallbladder to get bile out of them, and that's all they do their whole life. They're in a cage, and I don't mean a cage where they can move around, I mean a cage where they cannot even move. And if we took all the energy that we put into SeaWorld and we said, get the orcas out, what if we took all that energy and we put it towards moon bears and rescued thousands of moon bears, or being tortured and don't have good quality of life at all. I think that there's a lot of bigger enemies out there and worse scenarios are going on that we need to be aware of. Rusty?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so looking at this like from an economics perspective,
yes.
there's obviously a lot of demand factors both on the habitat and on the animals,
yes.
like farming would be a big one on the land side of things, and on the animals, I suppose, harvesting for alternative medicine or skin or ivory trades would
yeah.
be a big factor. Are zoos, has there been any research on the demand that zoos place? I've seen the old John Wayne Atari movie, like the zoo calls up, we'd like a kudu, and they go round it up. Is that a significant demand factor that's actually helping keep these animals in place? Because it's funny to tell don't they have zoos otherwise.
I'm not 100% sure I understood your question. So are we like taking the animals from the wild and is that making an effect on the demand for them? Is that
what I'm saying is perhaps the zoos are a customer of the animals that support them not being shot for Chinese medicine or ivory trade.
I'm not sure if that plays an impact. Most animals that we have in zoos are born in zoos currently. We're not going out and collecting animals, so that doesn't necessarily mean that they're being protected because of like, well, let's not use them for ivory. I can sell them to a zoo and get money. Most of the animals that we have in zoos are born in zoos, or they're animals that can't be released back into the wild. As far as the demands, economics, I like that you mentioned that economics is huge, and that is like the biggest role of what plays a part in conservation and what's happening to animals. So like the palm oil industry, for example, we're putting a demand on food to the palm oil in them, so of course they're gonna keep making these farms, and those people in Indonesia don't have a job except to make these farms. So we have to make new jobs for these people or keep sustainable farms going only and not make new farms. But I don't think that zoos are protecting the wildlife from being taken. I think our conservation is protecting them, changing laws are protecting them, educating others. It's just awareness. It's really awareness of people stepping up to make changes that are protecting them. So I'm not sure if I answered your question exactly.
Are there companies out there that get calling orders, hey, we'd like an elephant? I mean, there have to be, like some zoo in wherever must be ordering the animals.
Well, I can't tell you where all places get their animals. ADA accredited facilities and most of US, Canada, Europe, we share animals and we actually transport animals back and forth, and that's how we get our animals. So, right now we're like, let's say we're breeding growing owls, and then someone in Texas is like, hey, I'm growing owls with it, and it's growing owls, and we're like, okay, well, should we be a growing owl? And that's how I get a new animal. So we regulate everything that we share, and we don't breed unless it's important to you and it's maintaining the genetic diversity. We don't want to have a bunch of animals that are bred that they have all the same genetics, because there's no purpose in that to allow them to go back to the wild in the future. James?
Okay. I have two questions. One, what would be your like top three zoos?
Top three zoos?
Traveling with town. What would you do? Where would you do?
San Diego Zoo is amazing. the world famous, and they do a lot of conservation. They have an entire portion of the zoo that's not like open to the public, that is 100% conservation research, and they make amazing choices. The National Zoo is beautiful, and then I'm biased, and I like Cornwall Zoo. So I don't know, I love all of our zoos, and I feel like a zoo doesn't have to be accredited for it to be a high quality zoo. I think if you're observant, you can see what are good quality organizations, and if the animals are well taken care of, you'll get a sense of that. Marco?
How many people do you think would have to go to that the Palm website to actually increase the demand? I mean, drop numbers, I mean, I'm just curious, right?
Yeah, to drop the demand for palm oil, I think it's a big battle. It's a hard one. And there's a palm oil, it's like a group organization that they meet yearly from different parts of the world, and they talk about the issue because it's such a big one. And they bring information from the palm oil farmers all the way to, you know, the United States people that want to eat their Nabisco's and eat, you know, like. So it just depends. I think that it's going to be a hard battle, but the heat is not eliminating using palm oil. The heat is using sustainable oil. So oil that's already been farmed, already been created, that we're not burning down new rainforests to make palm fields. And then economically, I think this is one of our biggest battles in all conservation, is helping the people have jobs in those locations. So right now the lion numbers are dropping, and people don't realize that lions are threatened. Well, the problem is there's poachers out there, not just getting lions, but they're getting the food of all those, what the lions eat. But they have to, because that's their job. If they're not a poacher, they don't have money to take care of their family. So there's an organization out there that goes out there and they give those poachers jobs to become anti-poachers. So they take all the knowledge that they already had, they get a job to become anti-poachers, take down snares, and protect the wildlife. And so because they actually have a job, they don't have to go out and do something else. They don't have to go out and kill lions. They're not just saying, don't go out there and poach. And then they're like, well, I have to feed my family. We're actually giving them a job in their community to help. This is happening all over the place. This is happening in South America. We're helping people find jobs. India, we're helping people find jobs where they don't have to go out and hurt animals or hurt the environment. That's the biggest thing. I think conservation happens at home. Like, you have to be at the source to make a difference. Yeah, I see.
Yeah. On that palm oil thing, Dove soap—they put out an ad about the faces of Dove, showed, you know, faces of different types flashing across the screen.
Yeah.
How good the product was, and then somebody did a parody of it where they showed all the forests getting cut down in palm oil, and that cut Dove out of the knees. So, are there main perpetrators of this palm oil thing that could be singled out like Dove was in this anti-Dove campaign?
Some places have been singled out, and people have protested, like Girl Scout cookies and Oreo cookies, and, you know, I don't want to be like, don't go out and eat these foods, but I think it's just about knowledge. I think it's about us changing things. And for palm oil, I don't know how far away we are from this step, but what I would love to see is foods that have like a stamp on it that say like orangutan friendly. I mean, 30 years ago we were killing dolphins because we were eating tuna, and then they realized it. And they're like, okay, well, I don't want to kill dolphins, and I don't want people not to buy my tuna, so I'm going to put a stamp on this and say, this is dolphin-friendly tuna. And who goes out there and buys tuna today that isn't dolphin-friendly? Nobody. So I think education and pushing for sustainable oil and making it more public, so that we do have like a new box of Oreos that say, this is orangutan-friendly. Girl Scout cookies, this is orangutan-friendly. That's our goal. I mean, that's where it has to go. I don't know how far away we are from that, but I know that there are people working on that.
Somebody may submit, he submit a picture that has an orangutan smashed between two Oreos as the cream. That would be a sneer campaign.
That would be cool. And I'll be honest with you, 5 years ago, I didn't even know about palm oil. I didn't even know what the issue was, and I was in the zoo field. So it is new, and that's why educating yourself and sharing that information is so critical. Lisa?
So you're talking about conservation and then zoo, like a lot of programs, and then together with other like animal refugees. So
conservation programs, but I can tell you that zoos, because conservation is becoming so much more important, they're actually narrowing in their scope of the kinds of animals that they're having in zoos to go along with their collection plan for conservation. So everything's becoming more and more conservation oriented. So, you know, when the animals pass away from old age, we have some empty exhibits and they're like, well, what are we gonna put in here? They're not just randomly being like, well, let's put a monkey in there, let's put a, you know, this and that. And they're actually looking, what animal can we put in here to help the public? What animal can we put in here to help conservation? What animal can we put in here to drive the species survival plans? So I think that scope is narrowing down. There are animals that zoos have to help bring patrons in. Zoos can't function without patrons. So yes, it's important that animals are there that people are interested in seeing. That's a bottom dollar red line thing, and it's the truth of how a zoo has to function. But we're not just like, well, let's get 20 giraffes because that's all people want to see. You know, we're like, well, let's get giraffes. People love giraffes. But let's do giraffe conservation at the same time. So those big animals, they matter, but our purpose matters as well. Finally,
I was just gonna say, let's just say along that, mention like kind of what you did where they have like a thought that they didn't hear about that.
My mom is here today. She's sitting right there. She was a docent at the zoo for 10 years, and she would help animals that couldn't be released back into the wild. She would go out to schools and educate kids about these animals that couldn't be released back into the wild. And even education and getting those people connected with those animals, that makes a difference. So you're asking about like what kind of animals you have, those are those animals that can't be released, and they still play an important role. So animals are selected, not just by conservation reasons, but those other reasons that I told you about, rehabilitation, education, recreation matters as well, but all those matters come into play. Stop.
I have a daughter who's interested in being a veterinarian. She has a veterinary program. How much school would she be looking at?
To become a veterinarian takes a long time. It was like 8 years or something crazy like that. UC Davis in California is one of the top schools in veterinary medicine. That's what I would recommend if you guys can just go wish somewhere to get there. Does she want to just work with domestic animals, or does she want to work with exotics as well? Okay. So there are exotic veterinarians, but it takes longer to get there because you have to have practical experience. So doing internships and being in a zoo so that you learn the differences. Because hand-dog veterinary medicine, that's hard, but then you gotta start looking at, okay, well now you have to take care of everything from a snake to a gorilla, you know, so you have to get that specialty in by like doing internships and specialty classes to get that variety that's open. I'll try and think about, if you give me like your number or something or email, I can send you some information about where our vet's going to. That's okay? Okay. I can't see your name.
Peter. For my job, I make crowns as a lab technician. And I've seen in magazines that like dental work for zoo animals is becoming a big thing. Is that something that happens at Vocal?
Yes, we have specialty dentists come in, especially for our apes. We'll do root canals and crowns, and but we've also had the dentists come in for smaller guys too, like the Hinju, which is an American family. He does have bad teeth, so we're like, hey, can you come look at this guy's teeth and tell us what we can do? We also have ophthalmologists come in and do surgery on eyes. There's a vet clinic in Salt Lake that has a picture of our howler monkey in a newspaper frame because they removed cataracts from his eyes and now he's not blind. So we do communicate with other places. We call in specialty vets when we need it. I mean, we do everything we can for these animals. We treat them as good as people I mean, the best we can. You have a, you need a root canal? We're going to get you a root canal. You know? Marco?
Are there any of the animals that you perhaps feel a little bit uncomfortable around, or at this point, not really?
Safety is important. There's no animals I'm actually scared of, but animals are divided into two groups. One is like free contact, where I can go in the same space with them, and then there's protected contact, which means there's always a barrier between us. So like, if I'm going to take care of the tiger's going to shift into an off-exhibit enclosure, so I can go in there safely, clean, put things out for the tiger, and then I'm in a safe place, and we shift the tiger back. So I'm not going to go in with a scary animal. Safety matters, and you can get hurt even with like little guys. So we are trained, and we also have really extensive protocols for the animals, especially the dangerous animals, to keep us safe, the public safe, the animals safe. So I think we're probably out of time. I know, Peter, I'll answer the question afterwards, but I think Mark's giving me the eye. So thank you guys for your time.